Hi, everybody, and welcome to From This Corner TV. We've been off the air for a little while due to illness, but hey, we are back, and we are strong tonight, four women strong, so get ready. So I'm Marilyn Dayton, your host and producer. We've got a great show tonight, and it's going to be about the transformation power, or transformative power, of arts and education. Arts education through collaboration, forming partnerships with schools and arts organizations. As you remember, last year we had a couple of shows about music and children and how children benefit from having music in their lives. We had Jim Papoulas, who had worked with Beyonce and Lady Gaga and other people, and he was very gracious on the show, talking about music with children. And then we had a couple of the Mystic Middle School teachers here, and they were wonderful. So today we're going to be focusing on arts, okay? And first of all, we have a co-host tonight, and she finally has said yes, and she's here, and she is Dodie Milardo. She's an author, speaker, philanthropist, TV personality, you name it. This girl has been around, okay? She's a romance novelist. Book is called... Okay, let me talk about
what
you, okay?
A reputation.
Her book is called Penelope's Cruise. And she's a relationship advisor. As a matter of fact, she was a guest speaker on Oasis of the Seas, one of the largest cruise ships in the world. She's been a math teacher and tutor, so she can speak to this type of a program. She's a dancing diva. And she's a tireless fundraiser. Who has enabled more than $150,000 from her contacts to go to charities. And she's a co-host on another TV show called Just Sayin' out of Branford, Connecticut. Welcome, Dodie.
Thank you, Marilyn. You make me sound like a diva.
And that's okay. That's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. Now, I'm going to introduce one of our guests, Wendy Berry. She's the executive director of the Southeastern Connecticut Cultural Coalition, Regional Arts Coalition Director. And she has experience in education. She has a master's in arts history and internships with the Metropolitan Transportation Authority's Arts for Transit, which is very cool, and New York Transit Museum, that have inspired her lifelong passion for the arts, art history, and public art. And she's published reports on the economic and social impacts of public charities in both Stonington and New London County. And Wendy, I'm so happy to have you
on
the show.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
And Dodie.
I'd like to introduce you to Kate Fioravanti. She is District Arts Supervisor of the New London Public Schools. Kate has a master's in arts education and leadership, as well as a bachelor's in music. She's been a multicultural arts and movement teacher in the New London, as well as artistic dean at Nathan Hale Arts Magnet School, which is also in New London. She's currently district arts supervisor to the New London Public Schools. She's been published in the New York Times, the National Education Association Today, the Day newspaper many times, as well as being featured on the National Arts School Network. Welcome today.
Thank you
for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay.
One of the things that we were talking about before our audience joined us was how you two met and what blossomed from there. So would you share that story with us?
We would love to. Absolutely. I'll start with that. It was actually a great meeting when we first came up. It came about because the coalition did a survey of all of our partners, which are 400 arts and cultural organizations within the region and surrounding areas. It includes artists, museums, historical societies, performing arts organizations. And we had listened for the first year and a half of our organization about what the needs were of our partners. And one of the needs and desires from the partners was that they were more connected to the school system and that they could be more of a resource to the schools. And so we wanted to kind of dive deeper. So we did a survey of all of our partners and asked them, okay, so what schools do you want to be more connected with and for what reason? Is it to provide to get, you know, audiences for your programs? Is it to do after-school programs with the schools and engage with the students? Is it to use them as resources in terms of a venue space? What were your needs? And the responses came back pretty solidly that every partner in general wanted to be connected with all levels of schools for all of those reasons. And so we really gained some information, but not enough to move forward with it. So we kind of turned it upside down and said, let's go talk to the schools. And let's see if we can find out from the schools what they need. And then we'll try to, you know, address that with our partners. So I don't remember how I actually got your name. I think it was for a few different referrals. There is only one of Kate's, kind of her position in the region. There's another coordinator for Norwich, but the arts district supervisor is unique to the region, so she was my first go-to. And I explained to her the situation that we had all these partners who want to be more connected to the schools, and we just began a conversation of, we have inventory, we have people who are clamoring to be connected to the schools, how best to do this, what was the what do they need, and so how do we connect, and how do we match make for that? And that was the beginning of the conversation, and you can take it from there.
Well, interestingly, I started my position, so my role in New London Public Schools is to create arts magnet schools. And so New London created this position to make sure that I was developing the arts magnet schools, but also making sure that all those schools had really were really rich with the arts, because we have multiple magnet themes. So when I first started my position, it was for elementary school. And I didn't have a cultural coalition to seek out, didn't know that one was being created. And so my first task was to go throughout the region and to meet every artist I could find and to talk to every arts organization and cultural organization that was out there. And really the conversation was, so what do you do, and what kinds of things could you provide? You know, what funding is out there, what grants are out there, but to really kind of create from scratch with each and every one of these partners. And it was a lot of work, and I thought, my goodness, if another district does not have somebody like me, I don't know how they are actually making these things happen. And so when we met, we realized that was the problem. Both the schools don't know how to reach out to partners that would really make a difference for them, but also the partners that are out there and the artists that are out there, they don't know how best to connect with the schools. And so what I was finding is there were some organizations who were coming and saying, we have a grant to work with your school, so we're going to come in and we're going to do this program. And I would have to say, well, unfortunately, that doesn't really connect with our curriculum. And as an administrator, I know that we have to make choices about what our students are doing. And sometimes if it doesn't connect with the curriculum, or if it doesn't make a lot of sense in terms of what is going on with their education or being age appropriate, it makes it challenging for us, even if it's free, which, you know, is surprising to some organizations. Even if it's free, sometimes we have to decline, you know, for a variety of reasons. And so, you know, and that's hard for us because these artists went to all these lengths to get a grant or to develop this program, and we can't use them. And so we started talking about what is the best way for us to connect the schools with these organizations and these artists to make sure that they are, you know, getting out there and being able to connect with students, and the schools are able to say, look at this rich programming that really enhances our curriculum.
And that was the name of the event that we developed together, was called Connecting to the Curriculum. And so it was geared towards our partners as a way to kind of bring them to the table in a very efficient 1.5 hour, actually ended up being 2 hours, summit discussion with a lot of educators, to really talk to a room full of arts organizations and professionals about what it means to connect to the curriculum so that they have a better chance of being able to work with the schools in a way that adds value to the schools, but also teaches them how best to, you know, find them, which grades, which programs, and not create these programs in a vacuum. And so by creating programs in conjunction with the schools based on their needs, they were learning how better to connect with them. So that was what we called it, connecting to the curriculum.
You mentioned curriculum a couple of times. Does Common Core and all the rules that are around Common Core affect this or dictate some of these programs be included or not included?
Actually, You could probably do a whole show or a series of shows just on Common Core. But I think
But as it pertains to the arts that
right.
we're talking, yeah.
Well, and that's the thing about the Common Core that's actually good news. Yeah. There's a lot of talk out there, and I think a lot of people don't really understand what the Common Core state standards are for. And even, you know, there's some videos out there that you could watch that those don't even really get at, you know, for someone who's not in education, how do you know what that even means? So at a very simple level, the Common Core is great news for the arts.
Great news.
Now, testing the Common Core, that's where the controversy is a whole other story. But the Common Core state standards themselves really are taking what students are learning to a whole nother level. And we're seeing, I actually was just in a conversation with a teacher today where she's very frustrated because a lot of the students that she's working with are so used to the fill in the right bubble and you succeed, but that doesn't work anymore. And really, it never worked. You know, simply having the right answer to something, but not really being able to explain why that was the right answer or what other answers might there be and how does this relate to other subjects, that's simply not the way education used to go. And so now it's requiring students to think and to explain their answers, to argue and to get into a big debate over, you know, what is this artist saying in this picture, and to watch third graders have an argument about why Van Gogh chose these colors and these brush strokes. It's a fascinating conversation to listen to, but that's what they're having to do now, is to actually come home and talk to their parents who weren't raised on the Common Core, and they're starting to have these conversations that make such a bigger difference. And the better news is that long term, for them to be able to explain what they're learning, they're going to discover things about themselves as well. And that's where it's such a perfect marriage with the arts. Because the arts, there is no right answer with the arts. There is, you know, every painting that's created, even if it's a reproduction of a painting that already exists, every painting, that's the first time that painting has ever existed. Whereas in math, 2 + 2 = 4,
forever.
That we reproduce that all the time. But every painting is every performance of a jazz piece, that's the first time that has been performed that way. Mm-hmm. So it makes the arts perfectly aligned with the Common Core because it's asking students to really look and see, and as soon as you bring the arts into it, you bring text to life and you bring you know, the meaning of something to life. There was a great quote from Richard Dreyfuss, who played Holland in Mr. Holland's Opus.
Yes.
And that Mr. Holland's Opus is a big no-no in the music world because it talks about music being cut from the budget, and that but at the end of the movie, no one saves it. And so we're supposed to love this movie because it talks about music, but it gets cut. And so Richard Dreyfuss at some event was talking, and you know, everybody says reading and writing, that is what you need to do. But the next question should be, but what are students reading and writing about? And that's where you get into the arts, because all of what they're doing, the reading and the writing and the filling in the right bubbles, what is it for ultimately? What is the purpose? And the purpose is that, you know, we're looking at our society and moving forward and making a difference where, you know, students couldn't do that before.
Mm-hmm. How do you define the arts? When somebody hears that word, they think automatically of paintings. Does it also involve drama and music? Mm-hmm. Can you just quickly define it so that we understand?
We probably have two different, you know, not definitions, but who we serve in terms of the arts. Mm-hmm. So for us, for the Cultural Coalition, arts are much broader. We include everything from performing arts and music to graphic design and architecture, creative economy businesses that are creating or manufacturing something, an artisan of some sort, artists. So we think of it in much broader terms of a creative economy. autonomy. And that does open the door much broader than people would think in terms of school programs for the arts. Arts for schools, and you can answer that. Mm-hmm. But for the Cultural Coalition, we have a very broad definition of arts, cultural, and heritage almost for all three. And it really does include for-profits and nonprofits and the creative world itself. So writing, publishing, printing, anything that you can use, pretty much everything is really is creative in some capacity. Mm-hmm. But our definition is pretty broad.
And in the schools, you know, most schools you will see have music and visual arts for the most part, and state law says that they have to have access to that in schools. But the National Core Art Standards, which are in their structure aligned with the Common Core, they include music, which is instrumental and vocal, also visual arts, dance, theater, and media arts. And so even, you know, filming this show right now, this is, you know, example of media arts or graphic design and that kind of thing. And so, you know, but those are probably going to trickle into schools a little bit, but then you're talking about more teachers that you have to hire. And so fortunately, we are in the arts magnet pathway, we have the opportunity and actually the obligation as an arts pathway to really set the stage, no pun intended, to have all five of the arts really prevalent throughout the school. And so we actually have a TV studio at Nathan Hale, and we're going to have dance studios at the Arts Magnet Middle School. And so those are part of the curriculum for all of the students.
Which brings to my mind, having a studio like this can be expensive. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. where does the money come from? I'm sure it comes from different places. Can you kind of let us know, help us be more acquainted with where the budget comes from?
So I guess it depends on which budget you're talking about. Mm-hmm. So the school's budget is obviously dependent on, and Kate can talk about, obviously taxpayer dollars mm-hmm. that goes into the school's budget, or private schools would have their own. For, you know, when we look at budgets in general, we have, our coalition serves 58% for-profit partners who are for-profit businesses and, you know, kind of work in a different, you know, kind of business model. Our nonprofits obviously have 10, you know, various budgets that range in enormous range and diversity of our partners. So if you're thinking more of the school budgets, that, Kate, you can talk more about mm-hmm. the school budgets, but I know that's where my tax dollars go.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, certainly the school budgets are there, and there's some state magnet funding that our schools receive. There's also grants that have to do with what kind of districts there are. But it really comes down to how are you prioritizing what you're spending. And also what grants. So a lot, the first year that we were in existence, I was very dependent on organizations that already had grants. And then being willing as a school district to co-write grants with these organizations, because then we have aligned what our needs are and what they provide, and so being able to do that together. So that funding has a tremendous value. But I'm also someone who, you know, I started my teaching job at a magnet school, and then I was a founding teacher of a charter school in the state. And we had really no money, and so we took a lot of donations. And, you know, there's some great organizations out there that provide instruments, and so if any of our listeners have any instruments,
we can help with that.
Many,
we can help connect.
Because we've had, we should probably actually talk about this, because there are people out there who have a saxophone or a flute sitting in their closet that's been there for 20 years, yeah. and we have students who right. do not have access to, you know, it can be very expensive to sure. rent right. an mm-hmm. instrument or to purchase right. and to outfit an right. entire school system with instruments right. can be very challenging. But as a school district, It's not as easy as maybe.
So it was one of the benefits is that
how would they reach you to do this?
Oh well,
who do they call?
Right. Well, that's who they can certainly contact us. Who we can contact them. Yes. But I want to touch on this. This is important. Part of the reason for the collaboration is that those are state dollars. That's government money, essentially, that goes to the schools. The nonprofits and our partners, predominantly nonprofits, are 501c3 nonprofit organizations that can actually accept grant money and donations. The collaboration that comes into play is there are federal dollars available for grants to support initiatives that collaborate between organizations and schools. There are statewide dollars available, there are regional dollars available, and there are local dollars available. Mm-hmm. So building up different pools of money to support programs that can better connect, or so our partners could apply for grants from federal, state, local, potentially, and work with the schools. But they need to be working in tandem with the schools to, you know, to have that money be well spent. Mm-hmm. And the more collaboration, the better.
Well, we had the benefit of having some magnet funding last year. And the best part about it was that the first thing I did was I started hiring those artists that are out there. And we brought in an artist who painted a mural in our hallway because we had this new building of white walls. And so she came in and painted a mural. And she got paid. So, you know,
as she
putting
should.
Aside the
as she should. There is no more starving artist model.
Exactly.
Get away from
and
it.
And so, you know, it really is, it creates this cycle where we're having magnet funding, but that enables us to hire all kinds of artists from all over, and artists even from other countries have come for 8-week residencies through Expressione's Cultural Center. So, you know, we've had these opportunities, and so this, you know, there's been a lot of criticism about the magnet funding, but that has enabled us to actually boost the economy, and the arts in general boost the economy, so the more the arts thrive, the more the whole region will thrive.
Right. And the more the children will thrive.
Right.
And let's talk about that just for a few minutes. The children will benefit from this program. Mm-hmm. How will they benefit?
Well, I think I'm sure you have your own. You know, obviously, a lot of schools have had to cut back on arts programming. It's considered not the essential programs for many schools. Mm-hmm. And so I think you've seen this, especially in the suburbs, some kind of cutback, many cutbacks on arts programming. So drama clubs are now having to go out and raise money from their parents and their families, and there's a lot more fundraising going on to help pay for a lot of clubs and activities that normally many years ago might have already been subsidized through the schools. So I think we're seeing this kind of, you know, need for these programs to exist in the schools, because we know that they benefit the students. We know that children thrive and benefit from music and from art and from stimulation, the creative world. But I think we have this issue where arts are considered non-essential to many schools in terms of budgets. We know that there's data to show that they are essential to learning, but it's very hard when you're up against the sciences and the maths and the programs that are really essential and tested. How do you test how arts, and there are certain, you know, ways you can do that, but I think you're the children will benefit in just having arts be part of. And I think the data, just there's tons of data about how arts learning, arts education benefits students and how well they learn, how they can interpret information. It's just very hard to get that through sometimes to a board of finance who's making decisions about which are essential programs to have.
Can you give a specific example? Because I in reading to prepare for this, I read that it's arts enable students to be more successful in school, in work, and in life in general. It would probably help for people to know specifically, if you can talk to this point, how do they benefit? What does going to an art class provide them with? What kind of a skill?
Right.
They become more successful.
I will let Kate answer that because I know she's got good data.
Okay.
But I can tell you that a recent survey, and I think it was about a year or two ago, of corporate America, of all the higher executives, they went and found it and tried to research and study data about their success and how they can attribute some of those successes. And the arts played a major part of in their mind. They were able to attribute success to a music class they took, to a creative skill. The ability to think creatively often comes and is inspired through arts classes of some sort. But it was interesting. It's information that we know in terms of corporate success, that an arts background or education growing up, in some way, they can say that it was partly responsible, or they can attribute their success to in something. Now, that's just the corporate world in many parts, but I know that you have good data, I'm sure, on why the arts are beneficial.
One of my favorite statistics, actually, is a study that was done that determined, you know, because you're talking about this corporate and how the impact it has. Well, the impact is award-winning. So if you look at scientists throughout the world, so maybe some parents think that if I send my child to STEM, that's really going to be what has them be successful.
STEM,
the buzzword out there.
Is STEM. Science. It should be STEAM, but we'll go with STEM for right now. We'll change it to STEAM.
right, with the A. Got it.
It is science, technology, engineering, and math. And so parents are thinking, well, those are the key things that they need. Mm-hmm. But if you look at scientists everywhere, the ones who have actually won Nobel Prizes for the sciences they studied, they're 17 times more likely to have studied the arts and to be artists.
Okay.
And so you can be a scientist, but without that creative outlet and studying the arts, they said not just doing some arts every once in a while or liking the arts, but actually studying the arts makes them 17 times more likely to win a Nobel Prize.
Wow.
I mean, that's an interesting statistic.
That's huge. Well, and I think that speaks to the budget issue, where people are trying to decide how they should, their taxpayer dollars are being spent. Mm-hmm. They'd be more inclined to support the arts if they knew a statistic like that.
Yes.
You know, that their kids that are going to school could be more successful. Right. So that's
fabulous.
And I'll
tell you a story, too, that's more closer to home. So it's actual students that we have in our district. Hot Schools is a designation in Connecticut. Stands for Higher Order Thinking Schools. It's been around.
I haven't heard before.
Yes. And it's called a hot school. And it started about 22 years ago, and it's a designation for schools in the state that focus on the arts and arts integration and democratic practice. And so our arts elementary, Nathan Hale, was designated as a hot school. And so our school did a partnership, and this is part of being a hot school, is you partner with teaching artists who are, you know, we have multiple master teaching artists in this area. It was Flock Theater came in to our school, and they collaborated with our teachers. And so they did all this planning with our fourth grade teachers. And there was one teacher who couldn't be part of the planning, and so his class was not part of it. But they planned a shadow play. And it was, the students actually wrote this play, and it was tied with social studies. And so this particular year, it was on our whaling unit. And so students actually wrote this play with Flock Theater, and then they chose students to play certain parts. So there were students who were actually running the lighting portion and students who were running the shadow portion, and then there were the narrators. And the narrators that they chose were the students who had the lowest scores for reading fluency. So in other words, when they're actually reading, how fluent are they as they read? And so they did the testing, and they figured out which students actually had the lowest fluency scores. And so for these three classes, they did this, and those were the students who were the narrators. So the worst readers were the ones who were reading, which was a little scary for them, but it was a great opportunity. And so they did this whole arts integration unit, and by the end of the unit, so remember, there's one class that didn't participate. And so they looked at the scores for the students, and in comparison to the students who were not part of the arts integration, and their scores raised because they were still getting the standard curriculum that they would get in any fourth grade class, and so their scores went up. However, the students that participated in the arts integration unit, their scores went up twice as much. I mean, doubled the amount of impact that it had on their reading fluency, not to mention their confidence level increased, their feeling amongst their peers about how successful they were. because they really drove that play along. And so that collaboration is something we did the first year, and we've continued that, and then incorporated those kinds of things. So it's not just, here we are, we're planning this unit, and we're going to implement it with our students, but now we're going to look and say, okay, what impact is it having? And we're seeing that, you know, across the board, the students are, it's having a huge impact on their achievement, but selfishly, it's having a huge impact, as I can see, on their self-worth and their self-expression.
I love that. Yes. And we have to take a little break, and maybe that's, I don't want to, but maybe that's a good spot to take a couple of minute break. But hang in there, we'll be right back.
Can you help me with this? My new dad teaches me all kinds of stuff.
Sure.
He helps me with homework.
That would be 3.6795.
Thanks.
Yep.
He helps me with my decision making.
I wouldn't use this one. Ever.
And he's even teaching me how to drive.
And that's why cars have bumpers.
I'm learning so much.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are. When some people struggle with their mortgage payments, they become frozen, petrified. Not knowing what to do, they do nothing. But the people who take action are far more likely to get the most positive outcome. Making Home Affordable is a free government program. Call now to talk one-on-one with a housing expert about the options that are right for you. Real help, real answers, right now.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Up, college is hard. Down, those books are heavy.
My sport is football, but my passion is education. So every year, I take promising high schoolers on a college tour to show them that higher education means a brighter future.
My name is Namdi Asamoah. I don't just wear the shirt, I live it.
You can be a reader, tutor, or mentor too. Take the pledge at liveunited.org/volunteer.
Do you wear this?
And hello, we're back. I'm Marilyn Dayton, your host and producer for From This Corner TV, and we've been having a very interesting discussion with our co-host, Dodie, and we've got Wendy, and we've got Kate here. And the interesting thing is we've been talking about the benefit of adding arts into the school for curriculum, for enrichment for the students. And what I'm kind of hearing here is that when we're talking about studying reading, writing, and arithmetic, as they used to say, we're talking about logical things that you're memorizing, that you're not really using the creative side of your brain as much. So it sounds like when you introduce arts into the curriculum, whether it's music, art appreciation, dance, theater, all of those things, you're actually encouraging the students to use their entire brain, both sides of the brain, if you will. And it's making them more receptive to both the logic, the logical studying, as well as the creative. So with that in mind, Dodie, you have something interesting that you read.
Yep. It's kind of carrying over from what we were talking about before the break. I read a quote from the Chicago Arts Partnership in Education, and they said that teachers also consistently report developing new appreciation of students formerly perceived to be problematic. Now, as a former teacher, I totally understand that when you have a student, I was teaching math, okay, had a student who was causing problems in the classroom, maybe they were bored, maybe they didn't get math, okay, but if you could see that student in another set of circumstances where they were excelling, wow, now you have a different perspective on, just because math isn't that student's forte, it doesn't make them a bad person, you know, and then you now can respect the student, and the student getting that respect from you can kind of maybe interact better in your class as well. I just thought that was fascinating.
Sure.
Can you speak to that?
Yeah. Well, there's actually a school in Massachusetts that like got rid of their security guards and their metal detectors and increased the amount of recess music and art, and had a significant decline in discipline problems.
Wow.
And so it is absolutely true, and I've seen it when I was a teacher, and I taught music when I taught, and I remember one year a teacher came in to see my swing choir, and she said, oh my gosh, that must be a tough, you have every frequent flyer kid who often visited the dean. You have
frequent
helicopter parent
every frequent flyer in your swing choir. How do you manage? And I couldn't even tell you that which one that they were talking about, because I didn't experience that in my classroom.
Right.
And it's because these kids were able to express themselves in ways that they couldn't elsewhere. And I even remember when I was a student growing up in this area, I would have to work on my 10th long division worksheet in my Spectrum math book. And because I had mastered long division and it was boring and rote, and they would not let me go to chorus because I hadn't finished that work. Mm-hmm. And that's the example I use all the time, because I'll never forget sitting in that classroom not getting to go do that thing that I loved the most.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I wasn't so much a troublemaker, but can you imagine if you're not allowed to express yourself the way you want to?
Right. In your own way.
You're going to get bored and you're going to not feel so good about yourself. That's when you're going to start acting out. And so the more arts you have, the less you're going to see the discipline problems if you're really letting kids express themselves.
There's actually organizations, and I know Kate knows them, many of them around the region, but there are many who work with children after school in programs that can, you know, Writer's Block is the first one I think of. Mm-hmm. Writer's Block, Inc. is in New London, and it serves a relatively small amount of, in terms of population, but it's, you know, kind of inner city kids who have, you know, something going on in their life, but they can use the arts. And I think it's the stage and the play is what they use, but the kids are offered a platform in terms of music and performance to take on social issues like bullying, like drugs, like alcohol. You pick the social, but they find a way to express themselves in and then do a performance actually that they can perform to a large audience of family, friends, and relatives. But it is using the arts to affect change and to raise awareness of issues, but it is a form of expression, it's a form of education. So I think the arts are just one vehicle that can be used in terms of self-expression and education themselves. But it's, you know, the arts themselves, it has always been taken for granted that the arts were kind of essential to learning or essential to your kind of growing up. I was part of we had an art club, but it's not taken for granted anymore. These programs are being cut. And the arts have recently done a much better job of trying to show their value, but we're way behind the curve in demonstrating that value. I think these, you know, STEM areas have shown their value and obviously been accelerated because of what STEM does for a person's in terms of, you know, future and the businesses and their job, career choices. But the arts have always been this arts for art's sake. And it's only been, and I think it's, you know, there's always been staunch advocates who've been able to show the value of the arts, but there are economic benefits to it. There are career benefits. We often go and take children to performances and museums, and they look at the art and think, do I want to be an artist? Well, I take them and think, do you want to be a curator? Do you want to be a framer? Do you want to be the person who's an exhibit designer? Do you want to be the graphic designer who actually does the museum's promotions? There are at least 50 different careers you could take on by working for a museum. Mm-hmm. So I think that's where the arts have not done a very good job of saying, this isn't just arts for art's sake. This is a potential career, and then the added benefits are the creative thinking that you gain, the arts education. So there's so much more to the arts field, arts education in general, that they can gain, not just creative thinking, but truly these are career opportunities. These are possible jobs for these students down the road that we need to start to show them. If you like film, you may not want to be, maybe you want to be Quentin Tarantino, but look at the end of a movie. All those credits of all those jobs that are available in the film industry, and the list goes on from museums and historical societies. So these are professions that we want to encourage them to potentially become the future of
this. And all of those jobs are essential.
Right, absolutely.
Even the caterer, the gopher. I mean,
exactly.
You cannot make a movie without all of these tons
absolutely.
And tons of people. Mm-hmm. And what I want to just ask right now is, we've got an audience here, and what they're getting from this is that there exists a situation here that enriches the children, empowers them to learn in better fashions. And how can we encourage them to get involved? How can they help? What's the list?
Well, it depends on who you're talking about, but I think for parents, I can speak to parents, and Wendy can probably speak about organizations in this area. But parents often they don't realize that the arts actually, so speaking of careers, allowing your child to really pursue the arts or go to an arts magnet school does not mean that your child has to go into an arts career. There's, so many different ways that we've talked about and could talk about all day about why the arts has an impact no matter what. So I've seen many of my students, former students who've gone into the arts, but more often than not, they're going into other careers. That being said, there are careers that, like video game design.
Right.
Composing the music for video games is the most lucrative music career that is most lucrative.
Is that right?
And they actually
amazing.
Have a major at like Berkeley and schools like that. But also, stepping back a little, thinking about, it's not just about the arts, in a very specific way, but more thinking about what the approach is for a school. So, we might have all grown up going into a class and having our worksheet and filling it out, but that's not how it works anymore. So you'll go into a class and, as a hot school, we focus on Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences. So the linguistic, logical, mathematical, musical, visual, spatial, interpersonal, intrapersonal, naturalist, existential, and bodily kinesthetic. So allowing that kid who
my kids are learning that?
Well, think about it. That kid who just can't sit still, what happens is he is, or she is, sent to the principal's office or whatever, but there are kids who they need to be able to get up and move and show on a number line on the floor through dance and movement. There's all different ways for kids to be able to excel that are not the way that we learned when we were younger.
So we need to encourage them as grandparents, as parents, as older sisters, older brothers. We need to listen to what they want to do, what they're interested in, and just let them do it. But they have to do their homework.
Yes.
Right. And to know that I think just along Kate's point, a career in the arts does not mean that your child is going to be poor, starving artist. I mean, I think there are incredibly lucrative, very successful careers, and I think we have to do a better job of saying that the arts are not a fluff and that it's potentially, oh gosh, they want to go to art school. Mm-hmm. What are they really going to do with their life later on?
Yeah.
We need to do a better job of showing them the applications of an arts education, that they do the same way that science can be applied to many different industries. Mm-hmm. The arts can be applied to many different industries as well.
Mm-hmm. What I like about all of this is when I used to teach math, I would get, what do we have to learn this for? I'll never use this. But you're giving them the practical applications of going into a career and the things they're going to need to learn in order to make that a successful career. And math may be one of them. So in certain situations, maybe it isn't. But in others, it's definitely a requirement that they're going to need to. The other thing I wanted to mention was when I was in elementary school, we had a program for reading called SRA. Now, I hate to tell you how long ago this is. A long time, okay? Late 50s, early 60s, okay? I was not good at this. I was a great student, but I couldn't read fast. Mm. And they had this projection system where the words would be projected across the wall in the front of the room. And the machine kept going faster and faster. And if you couldn't read fast enough, you couldn't comprehend what was being said up there. Mm-hmm. And you could just forget it. Well, confidence level about reading, right. Forget it, okay? If I had been in the program you were discussing before where the worst reading kids got those narration parts, and I could have built my confidence up, yeah. I wonder where that would, you know, to this day, reading, because I'm a slower person at reading, what an impact. Yeah. And I'm realizing that now that we're talking about
this. It's learning parts, how we learn. So, yeah. I mean, Kate, what our summit actually achieved for a lot of our audience there mm-hmm. was to explain that school is different today than it was for most of us. Mm-hmm. That we are, there is a different way of learning than what we learn, other than memorization, like she spoke about. And the arts can teach, can help us to learn how to take information in, synthesize it and retain it in many ways. And I think it's just one, like I said, one different vehicle. But I think the arts just offer another approach, another form of how we learn things, how it resonates with some more than others. Some people, I have one son who is a memorizer. He's a great memorizer. Creative thinking, not so much. I'm mm-hmm. not going to say which son it is. But truly, I think it comes down to we learned this was what the Hamilton effect was all about.
I was going to ask you about that because I see the most excitement used to with my kids and now with my grandkids. We're going on a field trip.
Right, right. Yes.
We're going to pile in the bus and go do this thing.
Yeah.
And talk a little bit about the Hamilton effect.
Sure. Well, the Hamilton. Hamilton is right now probably the most popular musical in the United States in general. It's in New York City. It was written by Lin-Manuel Miranda, who actually did attend Eugene O'Neill Theater Center in Waterford early on.
Oh, wow.
So we can, as I said, we can lay a little claim here in this region mm-hmm. to him. It is a musical about the history of Hamilton, the president, President Hamilton. It is done through a largely very ethnic cast of characters, and it is rap music. It is it is not your traditional cool. musical. And what has happened is because it's a very, in my mind, it's a young, hip, very cool, but it has resonated with audiences way past. It's become this box office draw. And it also, through the process of its kind of first year, it becomes a great educational tool for teachers and for parents or for students that attend. They're learning about Hamilton the president and mm-hmm. his history and the entire show is focused on learning about President Hamilton. And so over time, some schools realize they'd love to get their students to go see it to learn more about Hamilton. It's a way to learn. They will actually retain it. So I think just in the past 6 months, national foundation gave a grant to, I don't remember how many New York City schools, but 10,000 11th grade students in New York City will be going to fund it to go see this show, to learn about Hamilton. And then curriculum study guides have been developed so that they take back then and study in the school social studies and history. And so but the kids are excited by it. They're mm-hmm. learning in a way that they're like, mm-hmm. it's rap music, it is cool, it is hip, and they're able to retain that. So the win-win-win that is the Hamilton effect that I think about is the arts organization, the actual, musical company, is filling their seats with paid tickets. They are having a massive show in success. The students who are coming are gaining in terms of educational value. And the schools are using something that's available to them to help teach their students in a way that actually is working. And there's a lot of impact there. So the Hamilton effect is these arts organizations who are offering wonderful programs are able to do their job, which is also, they are there to sell their shows. But they're filling the seats, so they're benefiting, they're affecting these students, they're creating a lasting impact, and it's all about education, and it's connected through the curriculum. That's the
fabulous.
Hamilton effect.
Now, that's so
fabulous. What if we have a philanthropist watching?
Oh,
and they
call me.
Well, we're going to be putting up the contact information for our two guests as they continue to speak. And it can be anything. If you have a saxophone,
right?
You
know, sure, okay, sure. Okay. Yeah.
If you want to donate money, right. and help the programs, right. If you want to get involved as a nonprofit, right. Or right. Even a profitable business,
absolutely.
Contact
mm-hmm.
Wendy,
yeah.
Because there is a process to this.
Right. So what we do, what I will say in terms of the philanthropist part, we actually found that at our summit, this was an unexpected mm-hmm. for me. We had, I believe, 7 funders that came to our summit. And when we realized on our list that foundations were going to be there, and they wanted to hear how they could fund programs that would do both, you know, fund the arts programs for what they are, which is wonderful, but also how they could have a greater impact with the students. Mm-hmm. So the funders came, which was not the target audience. The funders came because they wanted to have more value and more impact of the dollars that they were giving. So these were, and that for us was a really, really eye-opening for me in many ways to see that they were interested in hearing how they could do more with their dollars. So for the Cultural Coalition, we have a partnership process. We are a free member organization. And we want to know who's out there. So in order to connect with you and connect and play matchmaker, we need to know you're there. So artists, arts organizations, arts groups, mm-hmm. arts, even just a group of artists or performers, film groups, any kind of group, we need to know you're there. And so they register with us with a very simple form on our website that is just, who are you, how do we reach you, and which bucket are we putting you in? Performing arts, economic development, heritage. And that way we can inform them mm-hmm. of all the opportunities. They can attend our events. We have roundtables that we also organize and facilitate. But we also pass along grant information. We pass along any information that we can help to give them more efficient and streamlined, relevant information for them to do their jobs. One thing that we did learn at our summit that I thought was interesting was that the Norwich School District actually does an RFP, a request for proposals, mm-hmm. Every year, relatively new. That was unique. That's totally unique. And none of us had ever heard of that, which means they're literally saying, we need organizations who can do X, Y, and Z. We didn't know about that. We can help to get the information out to artists and to arts organizations so that if they are one of those who meets that request for proposal, they have the information to get that. So we need them to register with us.
So then how does it work? What is the process when you are putting together a partnership to a specific need with a school? How does that work?
So a few ways. We have many different opportunities for our partners to engage with us, and we gather a lot of information by hosting meetings and kind of what we call cultural conversations and roundtables so that we can hear what's going on, what the needs are. This is where we learned of the need to be more connected to the schools, the desire to mm-hmm. be more connected. We do a lot of, so we host a lot of meetings that are just, they can attend if they're in their peer group or even a peer group that they're not part of that they want to be connected to. We have summits that we offer, but I need to know them. Our staff mm-hmm. needs to know them. We need to know they exist. Mm-hmm. We try to make sure our partners are promoted in terms of what we do. Just self-awareness amongst own partners can help them to come together and actually collaborate to serve the schools better and collaborate and share resources. But I spend a lot of time talking to people. What do you do? And then when opportunities are presented, I know just who to call. Yep. I have my Rolodex. Our partner list is there. And once we have a searchable directory that we're working on, that will have kind of all of the museums, artists, everything, then all of our consumers and people can go there and say, I need a museum to do this, or I need a performing artist to do that, or I need a teaching artist for this. It will all be there for them so that they can find them themselves. But we're here to connect.
Now, do the schools come to you?
They are now.
That's what I wanted to find out.
Fabulous. Yes.
And that's the key part of this is, I am so grateful that this organization exists because, you know, part of for us is we don't always know and we want to be able to see what the opportunities are that are out there. Because what I discovered as a teacher, I would have students who came from all over because magnet schools, we take students from any towns in Connecticut. And so I would have students from some towns that, you know, it's a higher socioeconomic setting. And then students who were living in Section 8 housing, and these same students in our schools, and their ability to achieve at the same levels weren't there. And I realized that in part it was because some children are able to go to the museum with their families at the age of 3, and they're having all of these opportunities. So the achievement gap we're really talking about an opportunity gap. And so that's why when, you know, we have these schools and we have this, you know, magnet system where students are able to have access to all kinds of opportunities and to do this together, that's where you're going to start seeing a difference for all of the kids. Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's interesting because the magnet schools that I'm familiar with were all just high school age range,
right.
You know.
Not anymore.
You just made a fabulous case for the magnet school being in an elementary setting.
Right.
I never really thought about that before.
Right.
That's
and actually
fabulous.
Our opportunity in New London Public Schools, mm-hmm. That, you know, even though it's in New London, it's available to students from anywhere, which is great. And we have four magnet themes, and so students can really come in and choose. You know, obviously, I'm partial to the arts pathway, but there's a STEM pathway, and then coming in the future is a language and culture pathway and a leadership and public service pathway. And so students are able to enter that at kindergarten and continue on all the way through because they will have three distinct schools within each pathway from kindergarten all the way through 12th grade. And so you're getting, you know, the same curriculum regardless, but you're doing this through an approach that's a different kind of learning style and allows kids to thrive all the way through and stay with kind of a similar cohort.
But that's unique. That's New London in terms of what they offer. So this is why I love working with the schools and working with Kate and many others that were on our summit. Our partners are all over the region and even surrounding areas. And many of them have relationships with one school, but they want to have an impact with all the schools.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we serve 22 or 23 towns just within the region.
Wow.
And then you have all the individual schools and school districts. And some organizations they've done a fourth grade field trip to something, you know, every year. But that's the relationship they have. One school, one class, one teacher. What they want to be able to do is to be able to expand it to different schools so that they too can benefit from their programs. Our job is to try to figure out, okay, how do they create that relationship? How do we keep it and make it sustainable so that if a teacher changes a class grade, that program didn't just fall apart? How do people know who to contact if there's not a Kate? And remember, she's one. The other 19, 22 towns, however many, do not have one. So they do have to navigate a system where they're trying to figure, do I talk to the principal? Do I talk to a teacher? Do I talk to the PTO?
Mm-hmm.
We're here to help guide them and give them the information to make their lives easier. And then also offer the opportunity for them to collaborate.
Exactly.
So if a school likes a program and it's worked well, maybe we can help to say, why don't we do it for four schools and bring in three more organizations and do something really, really enriching that affects more students on a regional basis so that we can move the needle a little bit further.
And the school's making sure that they are working with these organizations to help them to enhance their programming to make sure that what they're doing is really beneficial. Like our teachers, for example, created a study guide with the Salt Marsh Opera Company to make sure that the study guide that went out to teachers all over the state was really beneficial to them. And that was a win-win for teachers and for that organization.
Well, I am sorry to say that we're down to the last minute or so, but I have learned so much. And to our viewers, write down the contact information for these two people who can make things happen for your children, okay? Thank you so much, Wendy. It's just wonderful. And Kate, thank you so much. You were both amazing. I mean, all this information, we could have talked another hour.
We could have.
And Dodie, thank you so much for being my co-host.
She will
be back, people. In the meantime, food for thought. I always like to end the show with a quote. And one of my favorite quotes has always been from John F. Kennedy, "A child miseducated is a child lost." Mm-hmm. To my mind, what that means is a child who doesn't receive the opportunities and the benefits of having arts balanced into their education system. I think that's something we all need to keep in mind. And if you want to get involved, if you want to learn more, if you want to find out if your children or grandchildren qualify for a magnet school, whatever you want to know, we have two wonderful resources right here. Okay? And so I would like to thank you for joining us. And of course, we'll be back again with a wonderful show. And just thank you so much for joining us. And we will see you next time.
Welcome.